Hello everyone, this is Dhiman. I'm really happy to share this result on the security margin of Tiny Jumbo with refined differential and linear cryptanalysis. This is a joint work with you, Damping, Ferdinand, Siwi and Yangjie, and was started in during the group discussion sessions of Ask in Japan last year. So Tiny Jumbo, as you all know, is one of the submissions to the NIST LWC competition, and say in round two. And the AEAD setup, I think all of you know, so I wouldn't spend time on this. This is the basic interface which Tiny Jumbo supports, like being the requirement. So it was designed by Honjunu and Tao Huang, and most of you would be familiar with this, the predecessor, if I can say, the Jumbo, which was part of the Caesar competition. And Tiny Jumbo is actually, as the name suggests, it's a small variant of Jumbo. So it's a family of AEAD schemes. Basically, it has three variants in its specifications, which vary in the also in the encryption security that they provide. Okay, and the authentication security is actually same all across. It's 64-bit level that it supports. And moving on, we will now first look into the specification of the algorithm, first the mode, and then we'll look into the internal permutation. So if I look into Tiny Jumbo, it has a very standard way of initializing the thing, but there is something interesting that happens during the initialization. Okay, so what is that? So if you can see that the initialization actually can be broken up into these steps. So of course the key is processed through a permutation first, and then subsequent to that the nonce is being processed in three blocks. Okay, so the nonce is 96 bits, that's a constant across all the variants of Tiny Jumbo as per the specification, and every time it actually absorbs 32 bits. Okay, and it's a duplex sponge construction, and this is something very important, that it absorbs the nonce in multiple blocks, and you will see why I emphasize on this, because this is something which was our point of interest. Now, another important thing I would like to highlight is this PK and PK hat. Both of these are actually the permutation, the keyed permutations, which are which differ in the number of rounds. So the PK is actually same across all variants. It has 384 rounds, but PK hat varies across to according to the key size. Okay. So let's look further, and then we'll come back to this. So after the key nonce has been absorbed, the next thing is the associated data processing. Again, the associated data is processed through the permutation with the lesser number of rounds, PK. Okay, and you can see that in the lower part, it uses some bits. And this, the designers call them as frame bits. Essentially, these are the domain separators. Okay, and you can see that as this the iterations, the number of blocks change, these domain separators also change, because the domain changes from the associated data, and next comes the plain text. Now, a very important thing to appreciate is for the encryption part, actually, Tiny Jumbo uses the bigger permutation, or I should not say bigger in the number of rounds, right? PK hat, it uses that. And finally, when for the finalization, when the tag is being given as output, the thing that has to be noted is again in two iterations. Okay, it breaks it down, so 64-bit tag, 32 bits every time it gives out. So there is one call to PK. Now, our point of interest is here, where we have PK, here where we have PK, and again here where we have PK. That is the permutation with the lesser number of rounds. Of course, that's quite intuitive why we are interested in that. Looking at the entire structure together, you just, as I promised you, this PK hat is actually the number of rounds vary, while PK is same across all variants. And again, this what it makes it's our point of interest, right? So it's that's where the permutation is. So we have these two types, right? And you can see the nonce is also same across, right? So now let's move on to the internal permutation. So the internal permutation of Tiny Jumbo is very interesting, because it's very minimally designed. It has got it is very, very simple in its structure. You can see it has got only one point of non-linearity, which is this NAND gate across these two tap points. Okay, that's it. And the key is gets XORed through this this place, that is the key bit. And based on the design, based on the variant, it will wrap back. So because the key size would change, but the, you know, the number of iterations would be more than the key size. And so it is just wrap around, right? So this is it. It's a keyed permutation, and it's basically a non-linear feedback shift register. That's it. That's all we have to say, right? And the non-linearity is just at one point. I think it's very minimal in that sense. Okay. Now, with this in view, with this knowledge, we can now go into what has already been done. So the literature in terms of the cryptanalysis, and in fact, this our work being the first third-party cryptanalysis, the results that we will show are basically credited to the designers, right? So let's look into this. So the strategy of proving resistance to linear and differential cryptanalysis is, you know, the standard one, that is using MILB modeling. After it was introduced by Moho et al., it is, I think, one of the most popular ways of selling your design by showing your resistance. So, but in case of MILB modeling, one thing that's very important is to model it properly. Now, in case of a very minimalistic design like Tiny Jumbo, it is quite pertinent that the authors or the designers used a way of just counting the number of active AND gates. That's quite fine, okay. But the problem is this sufficient? That's the question we're trying to ask, right? And our verdict is actually it is fast, but inaccurate. And we prove this, right? So the first thing that this model ignores, and we are not telling this, this has been shown in literature before, that it ignores the correlation that can happen between multiple AND gates, right? So they will get correlated, but this simple model actually considers every AND gate independently, hence it will miss that correlation, right? So it is basically overcount stuff and claim a probability that it actually it's actually in practice it will be lower than what it claims. Sorry, it will be higher in that what it claims. Okay, so number of AND gates would be lower. So designers ignore that. So that is one thing. So it will ignore this is one thing we want to note. The second thing is that this is quite well known that the effect of differentials actually can amplify the probability. So we can look at cluster of trails, okay, and then taking the probabilities together, we can actually amplify the probability. And the designers again didn't do this. So this is another thing we want to note. In terms of the linear cryptanalysis part, we would like to mention that the designers, the model that they've used was that they assume that the access to the input bits is there, that all the input bits, which is unrealistic in terms of the modeling the attacker, right? So with this, the next point we want to make is what is there existing in the literature that could already address this situation, okay? There are quite a few number of works that have come up of late, which show us how to do a MILB modeling that will be very, very accurate. Okay. The problem with these kind of modelings are these are very strict. They're strict because they will impose a lot of constraints on the system. And with these constraints, we know that the solver will actually struggle to give us a result, right? Most of the time it will not be practical. It will just keep on running and, you know, one day it's just give up, right? So though it has been noted in literature, though these kind of techniques are good in showing the validity of a given trail, they are seldom good to find the optimal ones, right? So with all this in view, we try to put this point forward that our motivation is to strike a balance between the both, so accuracy and efficiency. So what is our contribution? The first thing we note is that what is the problem with the simple model? Now, if we just look into this very simple way of looking how the restrictions on the input, actual value of the input, determines the output difference, that is important. And you can see there's a very simple AND gate, and we are just trying to see it is active, and we can show that it relies on the values of the inputs, right? Well, if we look at the simple model, what it does, it just, if there's a difference in at least one of the two input bits, the output of the AND gates has a difference with the probability half or doesn't have it with the probability half. That's all it cares about, and it considers all the inputs, all the AND gates independently, right? It treats them same and all them independently. So that is the fallacy here, which has to be overcome. And the simple model fails to capture both the things, both the correlation as well as the dependence on the values, right? And that is what we want to show us in the refined model. So there's a title suggests we are finally here with the refined model. So refined model actually tells us a very simple thing, that the same value that will shift, remember it's a shift register, right? It goes in this direction. The same value that shifts, the value if it enters the AND gates through S85, eventually after some rounds will enter it again through this, right? And that is what the refined model is all about. So let's look into a simulation. It's a very simple simulation. You have this entire 128-bit state laid out. You have these inputs. We are marking them as A, B, and C, right? And let's see what happens. So we first have the first AND gate. So the entry B. So B enters from S85 enters the gate twice. First of all, as B dot C. Next, after 15 rounds, it enters as A dot B again. So this is the thing. So twice, it enters AND gate twice. Hence, this value B actually is common to both, right? And hence, it shows us that there has to be some kind of correlation that will happen. And if I look, then this is the first order correlation, right? That A dot B and B dot C, for some values A, B, C, they will be correlated, right? And this is the first order correlation. Very simple thing. We are not trying to impose more. Just a very this first order correlation that we are trying to look into. And if I see in terms of the differential propagation and look at the actual values and how this propagates, let's see. Just the consider the event we are considering in terms of the difference is this is zero while we have a difference in the other inputs, right? The common input, the input difference is zero. Now let's look at the values. If the value is B is zero, then we see that both the AND gates are actually having an output difference zero with probability half. While if B is one, then both of them would take the value output difference is one with probability half. So this is the important point. This is a joint propagation happening. Either both propagate it or both do not propagate it. And here, actually, instead of under this particular event, we'll not consider them as different gates. Rather, we'll consider both of them as a single gate. That's all we are trying to impose in the refined model. So what would it translate in terms of the MILP? Very simple. Just model the differences. Okay. So the difference for the individual values, the difference for the gates, and finally this captures the correlation gamma ABC. It will capture the correlation that whether AB and BC are correlated or not. So we just impose a set of constraints over and above the simple model. The simple model is there. We just impose some additional constraints. Now let's look at this chain values. So okay, they will be going like this. So this chain values, then for consecutive couples, you have these consecutive couples in this nature. These are the constraints, additional constraints we are imposing. And this is what actually takes care of that 101 thing, right? If that event doesn't occur, this model actually boils down to the simple model, right? So what is the final thing? That subtract all values gamma ABC in the objective function. So the objective function like before, just subtract this additional value from that. This would result in single counting for correlated AND gates, while for the original simple model, it would have counted it. It would have over counted it actually. That's it. That's all the refined model. So now with all these ideas in place, we can look into the results that we have for the differential cryptanalysis first. So what is the thing that the designers claimed in the original submission document? They actually gave us four kinds of trails, right? The first trail was type one. So in terms of differential cryptanalysis for the simple model. So you can see these are the restrictions on the permutation, the input bits of the permutation. So for the if the input bits are restricted only to the 32 MSBs, then it's type one, output is unrestricted. The reverse is input is unrestricted, output is restricted to 32 MSBs. Remember, in the MSBs, we have those bits being XORed. Either the associated or nonce, everything is happening in the MSB side from that side. And then we have type 3. So type 3 is a very important one because this constrains both the input and output. Remember, both the input and output is constrained. So it is our point of interest in terms of forgeries. And then type 4 is unconstrained, which actually takes care of the underlying permutation, right? Now the designers claim that for 384 rounds, the maximum was 2 to the 80, which actually is good in terms of the security level they provided for authenticity. 64 to 80 was good. And then for type 4, they said the best they could do was for 320 rounds was 2 to the minus 13, right? And we proved both of them wrong, and I'll show you how. So in the refined model, before I proceed, let me show you what is the attack setting for the forgery. So it is very important. Remember, I am talking about type 3 trails, that is constrained both in input and output. Now let's think that we have with the first nonce, we have this delta I as our input difference. We have imposed this, right? So this goes here, this delta I, the input difference here. Now this transits to output difference, let's say here as delta O. This is the output difference here, delta O. So this transition from delta I to delta O with is some probability, maybe P, right? It happened. And now what we will do? with nonce, the second iteration of the nonce will give the same input, difference delta O, so that both of them are cancelled here and the difference here is actually equal to zero. Right, so delta becomes zero here, right, at this point, right. So hence, we have a collision and we will have a forgery, right. This is quite easily understandable. This will happen both for the case of the nonce as well as associated data, and we are interested because both of them, the PK is the permutation, it has got 384 rounds, right, which is the least possible here. So this is how we will capture do our forgery. It's very easy. We will take two, this is the input and the output differences, and this we want to impose, and using the second nonce we will try to nullify it, right. This is the setting for the forgery. Now we have an additional thing of reforgeability that comes up just because there's a multi-block absorption of nonce and associated data, right? What is this reforgeability? Reforgeability, as shown by Black and Cochrane in FAC 2009, was about the additional effort for the case of forgery. What is the additional effort you need for new forgeries once you already have one forgery? Okay, so in this case, it's quite easily understandable since the nonce is being absorbed through three blocks. Once we have this delta zero, we can actually take any value of this nonce, arbitrary value, so that every value will give us a new forgery, right? So the effort is negligible in that sense, right? So the MAC forgeability becomes an interesting case. Along with this, we also look at clusters of multiple trails to boost the probability, right? That is what this we already claimed earlier. That's what we did different from the designers. Now let's look at the results. The first is the type 3 trails observation on the 384 rounds. Now remember, the designers claimed 2 to the 80, but we found that there is no trail with 2 to the 80 that doesn't have a correlated AND gate. And if it has a correlated AND gate, definitely it is not actually reaching the 2 to the 80 probability, 2 to the minus 80 probability, right? So we actually found out with the refined model, 88 active AND gates with 14 couples. So 14 correlated couples, which have to be subtracted by our model, and the resultant is 2 to the minus 74. That's what we get. But we get 103 such distinct trails in our analysis, and we pooled all of them together, and this results to the complexity, effective probability of 2 to the minus 70.68, and just compare it to the 64 bits, right? It's quite near to that, right? So hence, the security margin is quite thin, if I can say that. Now moving on, for the next strategy was how many rounds can we penetrate while violating the 64-bit barrier, right? So find the largest number of rounds with security less than 64 bits. Again, we found out a trail with 76 active AND gates with 12 couples, correlated couples. Again, following the same logic, we get 2 to the minus 64. Okay, one thing I forgot to mention is the trail here actually gives us the final, means you can verify that, which can be verified, and the internal values here actually are given to reconstruct the trail. They are not a part of it. You can just highlight it just using the input and output itself. The intermediate values are given just to reconstruct the entire trail. Okay, now for 338 rounds, what we found was, we found 24 distinct trails, and all of these trails pulling together, the security results to 2 to the 62.68, minus 62.68. So the probability, this 338 rounds is the maximum we could get while violating the security claim of the designers, right? Now, another interesting observation we made when we look across the spectrum of all the, while searching for this, when we increase the number of rounds and kept on searching for the trails, of course, from the initial part, as the number of rounds increased, the probability got better. So this is basically score versus, so we have the score here. So this score versus, here is the number of rounds. So here's the number of rounds, score versus number of rounds. And you can see that we have three spots where there is some kind of a pattern emerging, right? Here, here, and here. Where we can see that there's some periodicity coming into the picture. Though there is nothing significant, or I don't have any result for that, I can't say. But it seems to be an interesting part where we have a periodicity where that probability seems to go below. Seems to go higher, right? With the number of rounds. So this is interesting, and it happens roughly 50 rounds apart. That's an interesting open problem, maybe for further study. Then if I look at unrestricted differentials, there we actually got results which we could practically verify. You see, we bettered the results with this for type 4 from 13 to 12 from the designers, and we also got a full round thing with 2 to the power minus 19, which we could easily verify. And the results are actually given in this GitHub repo. So with conforming pairs, we could generate. And this is the corresponding trail for that. And now moving on, we have also the type 1 and type 2 results. Now for type 1, we again bettered whatever the designers gave. We bettered. This question mark here indicates that the solver did not finish. So we bettered the results. Though the same cannot be said about type 2, right? But the interesting part is, if I look at type 1 and type 2 together, type 2 his output is unrestricted, and type 1 is output unrestricted, and type 2 is input unrestricted. Then you can combine both of them, and that is also a important for forgery, because it combining both of them leads to interesting setting of the forgery. So there also, if I combine them, then you can see this is for the full round 384, 45 and 28, where it is 41 and 28, and hence we get a 16 factor improvement over the designer's claims, right? Now, if I look into the linear cryptanalysis part, again, the setting is very similar, okay? So what we have here is, instead of approximating independently, when we have correlated AND gates, we can go for joint linear approximations, okay? And hence, improve the bias. So with joint linear approximations, the same idea, it's the same idea like before, we can actually go for a setting where we can try to improve the bias. This particular case here we are showing is a case where we can check the correlation for the tag. Remember, this is important because the tag is given out through two iterations in two blocks, and hence, and with one PK in between, which makes a good case for this. And the same setting applies, and the linear trails can be looked at. So the first results come in the form of the partially restricted key permutations. Okay, here what has interestingly has happened is, we found that there was no correlation. Okay, we could not find any correlated gates, but we still improved the results. 10 and 15, just see, this is very interesting. Okay, again, question mark says that solver did not finish. So what we have is, this is quite counterintuitive, because if there is no correlation, then our model basically boils down to the simple model. But then if the designers have already done that, then this result should have matched. So there is something going on here, which I guess is interesting. Again, if I move forward for the bias in the tag, so we find there's a 2 to the minus 41 bias for the full round. But again, this doesn't contradict, because this will translate to 2 to the 82, which doesn't violate anything. This is again the trail that was that has been obtained. So that's all for the linear results. Now, if I can summarize the entire thing, so this first third-party cryptanalysis of a Tiny Jumbo actually gives us some insight about the structural weakness of these kinds of designs. Okay, so you see, this multi-block processing actually gives us a very interesting thing. So you can't say this for a traditional sponge duplex constructions, but this multi-block processing makes this case for this forgery, makes the case for reforgeability. And so this gives us some insight for this kind of constructions. Okay, maybe it can be taken up by designers. And then we see that the refined model actually is quite accurate, despite not being too much strict like the traditional results we have in literature. So this is an interesting thing, and we can look forward to these kinds of modelings in future too. So in terms of the results, we saw that we have a very thin security margin left, 12% in terms of unattacked rounds, because 2 to the power 62.68 we get for 338 rounds. And in terms of the full rounds, we get 2 to the 70 minus 70.68, which leaves less than 8 bits of security in terms of margin. So it's very thin left for Tiny Jumbo. For linear also, we got interesting results, because we kind of improved the bounds from the designers, despite not having some correlation. That was important. Okay, and then what could be a solution? If I look into this, the solution could be improving the number of rounds from 384 to 512. Of course, that is possible, but this would impact the number or the throughput, right? So that is something to be taken care of. Again, if we take the refined model into consideration, we can choose better tap points by tuning the parameters and see that if the bounds can be improved, right? So I think that would conclude this talk, and I would really look forward to the live question answer session during the thing, the main event. And thank you all for listening. And this GitHub repo actually contains all the details. If you any interested researcher can look it up. Thank you again very much, and goodbye.